Hello and welcome to Conversations with the Indian Express. I'm Jyoti Malhotra and I have with me Pakistan's outgoing High Commissioner to India, Mr. Abdul Basit. Mr. Basit, welcome to the Indian Express.
Thank you very much.
You've had a very eventful three and a half year stay in India. But before I ask you about that, I also wanted to ask you about the situation in Pakistan right now, the political developments. Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif has been disqualified by the Supreme Court. What do you make of this?
No, I think it was a process which was followed, and he was disqualified. That is correct. And now I think the National Assembly is meeting tomorrow to elect a new Prime Minister. So I think the democracy is very much on track.
Some people are calling this a judicial coup.
No, I would not like to comment on that. A due process was pursued, followed, and as a result of that, we would have a new Prime Minister now.
What about the army? Again, there are comments that behind the scenes the army has played a very strong role and that they did not want Nawaz Sharif because of the old antagonism between the army and Nawaz Sharif.
This is not only passe, but I would say blasé, because this is something which is, I think it has no basis in my view. It was a judicial process, so whatever the judgment given by them, we all should be accepting that.
So other politicians like Imran Khan has also, his case is also in the Supreme Court. Do you think that he may also be charged under the same Article 62(1)(f)?
No, I would not like to jump the gun. Okay. It's a process. Let the legal courts take, you know, it's law take its course, and things will be decided there and then.
So you think this is a deepening of democracy in Pakistan?
I think so. I'm very confident about that democracy is indeed taking roots, and the way our civil society is, media, our judiciary. So we have very, very high hopes that things will, inshallah, continue to be getting better and better in the months and years ahead.
So where does that leave the India-Pakistan relationship? You've said very often that we must continue with dialogue, no matter that the relationship has been going through its ups and downs.
That is correct, because you know, governments come and go. We are talking about,
and high commissioners come and go.
High commissioners come and go. So we are talking about two states. And as far as I look at it, both Pakistan and India need to really see as to how they can put a dialogue process in place, which is, as our friend Manishankar Iyer says, is uninterrupted and uninterruptible. So we hope that at some opportune time this will happen, because we do have a comprehensive dialogue mechanism in place, which was agreed in December 2015 when Sushma Swaraj Sahiba visited Pakistan. So I do not see as to why the two countries should not be able to sitting across the table.
But High Commissioner, you know that the dialogue was called off by India after the strikes in Uri. So where does that leave the dialogue? If you have 18 army soldiers being killed by Lashkar-e-Taiba militants who come from Pakistan-occupied territory, then where does that leave the dialogue?
Frankly speaking, you know, the dialogue after the Pathan Code, the Indian Foreign Secretary was scheduled to visit Pakistan on 15th of January 2016. But then Pathan Code happened on the 2nd of January. So we could see that because the visit was too soon, we could see that was not coming. But the two sides sort of, you know, maintained the spirit of cooperation as to get to the bottom of the Pathan Code incident. So that was in itself a good thing that was happening between our two countries. But unfortunately, the Indian side kept on delaying the Foreign Secretary's visit to Pakistan to talk about talks, to finalize modalities for negotiations. I mean, one could understand a delay of a fortnight or a month even, but you know, delaying it indefinitely was not acceptable to Pakistan.
But there is a lot of anger in the country. After all, militant attacks or terror attacks have been there since the Mumbai attacks in 2008. It's going to be 9 years, and Pakistan doesn't seem to have done very much about the Mumbai attacks, the masterminds of those attacks.
know, Jyoti, actually these trials do take place. One must understand that Mumbai was tried as a very complex trial because the crime scene was Mumbai, India, and the trial is taking place in Pakistan. So in order to complete the trial, to you know, take it to its logical conclusion, both the countries need to cooperate sincerely and fully, in my view. Now, trials do take time. You, Samjhota Express for that matter, it happened in 2007. So we still do not have a closure. So, I mean, to say that Pakistan is, this Mumbai happened in 2008 and we are in 2017 and Pakistan is not very interested to conclude a trial, I think is not fair. Pakistan does need active cooperation from the Indian side to conclude this trial. I will give you an example for that matter, because in 2016, our foreign secretary wrote to his Indian counterpart for some information about the Mumbai attack.
What kind of information did they want?
It was about, you know, about equipment used and then some depositions made in the Indian, before the Indian court, one or two other things. But your side took 1 year to respond to that letter. We received it, you know, last year.
And what did they say?
I mean, they did propose a few things. So now we are working on that. So what I'm trying to underline is that these things need active cooperation. So if you expect Pakistan to be, concluding this trial on its own, that I think would not happen. We need active cooperation from the Indian side in order to move forward. And then one should not be prejudging the outcome of the trial. It is for the court itself to decide on merit.
So, whether it was Mumbai, whether Pathankot, Uri, the relationship in the last few years has been littered with these terror attacks. But in the meanwhile, we've also had the Prime Minister Narendra Modi going to Lahore to participate in Nawaz Sharif's granddaughter's wedding. So there have been good things as well in the relationship.
No, yes, I agree. Good things have been happening as well. As I mentioned earlier, the comprehensive bilateral dialogue mechanism, as the two sides agreed in December 2015, that also in itself was a big achievement, I think. But the problem continues to be as the two countries decided in Sharm el Sheikh in 2009, how to separate talks from terrorism. So that is the challenge.
So you think we should continue to talk and talk about terrorism as well?
Yes, why not? Pakistan never shied away from talking on issues related to terrorism, because we also have issues. We too are concerned about terrorism. The conviction of Kulbhushan Jadhav very clearly shows that.
We'll come to Kulbhushan Jadhav, but let me ask you about the two NSAs, Mr. J. Doval from India and Mr. Janjua from the Pakistan side. They famously met nearly 2 years ago in December 2015, and there are reports that they have met since a few weeks ago.
I would not comment on that, but I believe they are in touch with each other. Whether or not they met, I would not like to comment, but they are in touch with each other. And let's hope that this would help the two countries to come to the negotiating table and discuss all the issues which we have agreed in 2015.
But when you say they are in touch, what does that mean? Because I heard that recently at a conference in Moscow that the two national security advisors met. Can you confirm that?
No, I think you may like to ask, you know, your NSA to confirm or not to confirm. I would not.
But your NSA was there as well.
I haven't asked him. So.
Okay. But when you talk about the two NSAs being in touch, what would be on the table? Would it be Kashmir? Would it be terrorism? Would it be Kulbhushan Jadhav? What's on the agenda?
Kashmir, we do not expect them to discuss, because for Jammu and Kashmir, we have a separate stream, as was agreed in Ufa. We would expect the two foreign secretaries to meet as quickly as possible and to discuss all these issues which are important, you know, their solution is important in order for the two countries to build new bridges of trust and cooperation. Without Jammu and Kashmir, I do not see, frankly speaking, after having served here more than 3 years, I do not see as to how the two countries can even, can put their relations on solid foundations without resolving the Jammu and Kashmir dispute.
No, so Jammu and Kashmir was always very much part of the comprehensive dialogue earlier, but the conversation between the two NSAs, what do you think that would be about?
No, I think it's not a structured dialogue. They meet informally if they have even met in Bangkok, so there was no structured dialogue as such. For a structured dialogue, we hope that the two foreign secretaries would meet and, you know, finalize modalities for bilateral negotiations.
So the old dialogue where you had both Jammu and Kashmir plus terror that the two foreign secretaries discussed, do you think that would be a good way to take this forward?
I think we need a comprehensive approach, and the comprehensive bilateral dialogue mechanism which was agreed in 2014 provides, that is the most balanced document. It covers Jammu and Kashmir, it covers terrorism, Siachen, Sir Creek, everything.
High Commissioner, the SAARC summit that is to take place in Pakistan was cancelled last year. Preparations are on again for this year's summit?
We are in touch with the SAARC Secretariat in Kathmandu, and let's hope whenever all the members feel or find convenient to attend to have the SAARC summit, we will have. But it will be held in Pakistan, if not this year, then perhaps next year.
So you don't expect that this year, again in 2017, that maybe the summit is not held?
We are in the month of August now, or July, August. So, and you know, such summits, their preparations do take time. So my personal feeling would be that perhaps it will be convened sometime next year.
Okay. To return to the Kulbhushan Jadhav question, India has been asking for consular access to Kulbhushan Jadhav, and your government hasn't provided it.
We have not provided the consular access because we, as you know, the two countries do have a bilateral agreement on consular access of 2008, and it's paragraph 5 of that agreement clearly says that matters related to security would be decided on merit. Mm-hmm. So Commander Jadhav's case is a very sensitive case.
Why is it so sensitive?
Because he was involved in not only in espionage, but also subversion. And so that made it very sensitive.
So his mother wants to go to Pakistan to see her son. Will you allow her?
No, she has requested. But as you know, that the matter is sub judice at the ICJ, at India's behest. So we will see what is the outcome there at The Hague.
So until the matter is decided at The Hague, you are not going to take a decision on a visa for Kulbhushan Jadhav's mother?
No, I'm not saying that, but obviously now that since the matter has been being considered by the ICJ, so as I look at it, it would be more appropriate to wait for a decision by the court.
But what about a humanitarian view on this? After all, if the man has been declared guilty by a military court, you know, India doesn't agree with that, of course. But what about a humanitarian view?
But humanitarian, no. His mercy petitions are still pending. There is no decision by the army chief yet. And then if army chief rejects his mercy petition, then he has another chance to submit his appeal to the president. So the process is not yet over. So we can talk about issuing a visa or to his mother when the time comes.
Do you think Kulbhushan Jadhav could be another subject of conversation between the two countries, and do you think that would depend on an improvement of political relations between the two countries?
No, I don't think so. It's a subject of conversation between our two countries, because he was tried, he has been convicted on very, very serious charges, so there is no space for conversation or negotiations on that.
Now, India says that he was kidnapped, he was lured into Pakistan and kidnapped. What do you think?
No, what else India would say?
But he was kidnapped, wasn't he?
Not at all. He was arrested in Balochistan.
But how are your intelligence agencies, but he was lured from Iran into Balochistan, wasn't he?
No, I would, no, there is no truth in these things. But you know, remember that he was traveling under the fake name of Hussein Mubarak Patel. We found two passports in his possession, and so even the evidence is so clear that he was there, and he has been traveling to Pakistan. This was not the first time he was there. So he had traveled to Pakistan in the past as well. So he has been quite, you know, he has been involved in quite serious terror activities, as funding and since then, since his arrest, we have arrested so many foot soldiers and operatives inside Pakistan.
How many would you have arrested?
Oh, more than 100. I mean, they're in hundreds. And we have been able to bust many sleeper cells as well, on the basis of information provided by him. So it's not that easy as it may look, sitting in India. It's quite a serious case. That's why he has been convicted, and now the mercy petition process is underway.
Now, there has been some talk that a retired colonel of the ISI, Habib Zahir, also was, he came from Pakistan apparently on a job interview to Nepal, to Lumbini, and then disappeared.
That is correct. And we have sought India's assistance in that behalf.
What have you said to the Indians?
To locate him, to his whereabouts.
But why India? Why do you think, why have you asked the Indian government?
Because there are apprehensions that he may be perhaps in India's custody, we do not know. So we thought to approach India to see if they know about the gentleman.
But the man disappeared in Lumbini, which is in Nepal. Why would you ask India?
That is correct. But as I said, there are apprehensions. So there is no harm in asking the Indian government.
So what are these apprehensions, High Commissioner?
That he may be, you know, somewhere strayed into the Indian territory. We do not know the exact details. So in these situations, you do ask.
You do think that he has strayed, within quotes, into Indian territory?
No, I do not know. But it was, you know, kind of just seeking India's assistance. So I do not know whether or not he is in India's custody. I would not like to say that. But there is no harm to seek assistance.
And have the Indian authorities responded to your request?
Not yet.
So do you think there's some sort of an equivalence between the Kulbhushan Jadhav case and Lieutenant Colonel Habib Zahir's case?
Not at all. He was there to see, he was seeking a job there. So Commander Jadhav case is, you are mixing apples and oranges. Mm-hmm. So there is no analogy or comparison between the two.
And you've also asked the Nepalese authorities about Lieutenant Colonel?
Yeah, we are in touch with them. But so far, they do not know as to where he is.
So how do we take this forward, High Commissioner? You're going back to Pakistan in a few days from now. Where do you think the relationship is going?
I think we have to make a fundamental decision. And that decision would be that no matter what happens, the dialogue process should not discontinue or should not get disrupted. That is the fundamental decision which both the countries need to make. As far as Pakistan is concerned, I can tell you that we genuinely want our relations with India to improve, to normalize. But then you cannot put the real issues on the back burner in order to keep moving forward. Because if we try to overlook issues like Jammu and Kashmir,
or terrorism on the Indian side.
Terrorism, Indian side or Pakistan side for that matter. So all these issues are important, and we need to discuss these issues sincerely and try to find out as to how we can deal with them. And then meanwhile, I think whereas Pakistan is trying, as part of its Radul Fasad operation, because it's kind of all-encompassing operation, we are trying at our end to improve things. We also hope that the external dimension of terrorism in Pakistan would also be taken care of in one way or another. Secondly, we also strongly feel that the situation in Jammu and Kashmir needs to be improved, the way things are there. So all these things, once we decide to have a dialogue process in place, then we should, the fundamental decision is that we should not discontinue the talks. That, in my view, is the only way forward. Meanwhile, the CBMs which are already in place, we should adhere to them in letter and spirit. because we have invested so much in those CBMs. So those should not be allowed to fall apart.
Now, the External Affairs Minister, Sushma Swaraj, has allowed some visas, especially medical visas, for people seeking medical treatment to come to India. But it's few and far between. What do you think?
That was, from my perspective, that was unfortunate. But now we are trying to provide those facilities, medical, trying to explore possibilities of medical treatment of those patients in Turkey or in other places. And also, we are trying to improve our domestic facilities in this behalf.
So this letter that India requires from Mr. Sitar Jassiz's office, that still remains?
That is not going to happen because it doesn't happen that way. From which other country you need such letters, you know, from their foreign ministers to be written to your foreign minister? So we do not like to, you know, complicate things for ourselves.
Were you upset? Were the Pakistanis upset by this decision on the Indian side?
Definitely, Pakistanis are upset about that because this is something which is not done like this. If they are paying for their treatment, if all their medical documents are in place, so then why India would need a letter from our foreign minister or foreign advisor? This is simply incomprehensible.
And does this harm the people-to-people relationship, do you think?
It does in a way, because I strongly feel that people-to-people contact is one area where we should allow people to meet, cultural relations to improve. But unfortunately, in India, I do not see receptibility to these ideas.
And this could be divorced from perhaps, or separated perhaps from the government to government dialogue.
It is easier said than done, frankly speaking. I would not say that everything can continue if there is no political environment for that. Political environment is important. So we need to move in all, you know, in all areas simultaneously.
High Commissioner, one last question on Afghanistan. Afghanistan seems to have become an area of contention between India and Pakistan, at least behind the scenes. Nobody says it publicly. What do you think?
No, I think Afghanistan is a very, very important country for us. It has been our endeavor to see as to how we can help to promote peace and stability in that country, because for us to, you know, realize our own economic potential, stability in Afghanistan is a kind of sine qua non for us. So for us, Afghanistan is important. We would very much like that the regional countries, immediate neighbors or near neighbors, should stop interfering in Afghanistan. Only then can we realistically think that we can promote intra-Afghan reconciliation, which has to be led by Afghan themselves. Neither Pakistan nor any other country.
You talk about India. You think India interferes in Afghanistan?
No, I'm not naming any country, but regional countries are.
But the Afghans like they're in favor of promoting the India-Afghan relationship. Does Pakistan have a problem with that?
No, I do not have any problem with that. Afghanistan is a sovereign country, so is India. So they are allowed to have as deep a relationship as they would like to. But their relations, their bilateral relations, should not be against any third country. If their relations are negatively affecting the security of Pakistan, then obviously we have a problem. But so long as their relations are anodyne, there are no issues, that is for the development of Afghanistan, we have no problem, because we ourselves are contributing hugely in the reconstruction and development of Afghanistan.
So should India and Pakistan also talk about Afghanistan in a potential comprehensive dialogue?
No, I do not know yet. We have not yet reached that stage. There are so many other issues and we need to talk about them rather than going into areas which are perhaps not yet, which are political situation, environment does not allow us to talk.
Hi, Commissioner. Thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate your time with the Indian Express. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there, but you've heard just a very, very frank interview, frank comments by the outgoing Pakistan High Commissioner to India, Mr. Abdul Basit. His main message, of course, is that irrespective of the ups and downs in this very, very prickly relationship between India and Pakistan, dialogue cannot cease, that we must keep talking to each other. This is Jyoti Malhotra from the Indian Express.